Good evening, friends. Welcome to Money Works for Me special subscriber webinar for Rising Star. We will start our webinar sharp at 16:00 hours. Before we start, I would appreciate if you can help me understand, if you can listen to my voice clearly, you can help us know through the chat window. Thank you, Tarun. Thank you, Sunil. Thank you, Mr. Savar, in helping us know. In this webinar, broadly, we'll look at our Rising Star product. I would like to help you understand how we would go about using this product, because on a design basis, we have designed this product with certain different perspective in mind. As you largely know, we have been more value conscious than growth. There is a slight change for small cap product, especially we would like to have both value as well as growth. We would like to see that. Second, for most of our large cap products, we have not been so much focused on how a portfolio design would be. In this product, we will be more focusing on the portfolio level as well. And so I hope that some of you who have subscribed to this product, you would have got a risk profile survey, and you would have filled it so that you can see this top recommended allocation part as well as the your allocation, actual allocation part. In order to see your stocks and how the split is, I would suggest you can use the portfolio manager bot list to add whatever the stocks is. As we go forward, we'll try and integrate both of these things so that you don't have to go to multiple pages and add your stocks or change your cash level. We'll try and make it more integrated so it is much more easier for every one of us to use this. Now, the key thing to understand over here is that the allocation which is suggested to you could be different for each one of you. We have broadly divided into four categories based on the risk profile that you will get, whether you are very highly risk averse, whether you have a moderate aggressiveness, or whether you have a very high riskiness. So we have divided it across and on the basis of risk ability and risk willingness across and four categories. And on that, we have given you a recommended allocation for small small cap, mid cap, large cap, and cash. Now, how we look at it is that cash is perceived to be the least risky asset class. Large cap is perceived to be a bit more riskier than this cash. Mid cap is perceived to be more riskier than large cap, and small cap is perceived to be much more higher riskier. So if you breach, let's say, the recommendation for small cap, as in your small cap and recommendation exceeds, and that excess is coming from one of its mid cap, large cap, or cash, then you will start getting a warning kind of a signal over here asking you either you need to put in more cash or you need to rebalance your portfolio this way. Or if it happens otherwise, let's say your cash is at 30% as recommended for this hypothetical person, and in your say large cap, instead of 25%, he has 30%, but this has come at the cost of say mid cap of NLS. Instead of 30%, he is having say only 20%. So in the mid cap, he is having lesser than what has been recommended, but he is having more large cap than what has been recommended. The rest of the other been same, then there would not be any warning as such, because what he has done is he has gone to a much more lesser riskier asset class than what has been recommended to him. So only if your portfolio is ends up happening in a way that is that your portfolio is much more higher on the riskiness than it is, then it would start giving you a warning. And I hope you would use this tool to rebalance your portfolio once in a while, or at least ask us about what to be done. Sometimes it may happen that a company that was a small cap has suddenly increased in its value and it has tended to become more like a mid cap or a large cap company. Then we need to see whether it is a justified reason just for rebalancing your portfolio for because of the outperformance of the company. Now, the classification of whether it is a mid cap, large cap, or small cap is done based on the basis of our analysis of how a market should be looked at on the basis of large cap, mid cap, as well as small cap. We tend to look at the nearly top 75% companies as on the market cap some basis as large cap, the next 20% as in a mid cap, and the last 5% as a small cap companies. These percentiles are used, and every month, and we rebalance it at a we retag it all the companies to see if there is a change. So in the middle of the month, it may happen that a small cap company which may have become mid cap, but it is still tagged as a small cap. But because there are lots of about 5,000 odd companies, we can do this only in a once in a month or. This would be especially true as we move into the bull run, as most of the people are expecting. Now, if you look at one of the key questions that I saw most of the people were asking was that what was the basis on the which we have chosen these 24 companies. Now, lastly, if you look at one of the key basis on the basis of which we have chosen these 24 companies was definitely on the basis of performance of the company over a long period of time. But there are also some exceptional companies. Like if you look at Tata Sponge as a company, while if you look at it, whether how much kind of a balance sheet it has, how much strength the company's balance sheet has, if the company's strength of company's balance sheet is very strong. However, it is not a typical small cap in the search of a high growth company kind of a company. Let me just take you. If you see, it is not a high growth kind of a company. This 192 to 782 sales growth that you are seeing is not coming through expansion in capacity. It has largely come through an increase in the sponge iron prices. And it is that's why not necessarily a very true small cap company which has a very high growth. But if you look at the kind of cash flow it has had, the kind of margin it has maintained, we believe that it's qualified as a small cap company, but a change in thesis is needed. This has to be a deep value company. It has to be bought at a very deep value discount. Generally, it makes sense because for most of its history and most of its likely future, the incremental capacity growth is likely to be very less. Their focus on and maintaining their margins is going to be the much more stronger focus. And that's why a deep value strategy is a much more better strategy. On the other hand, if you look at some say, another company like On Mobile, on which we had also given our buy call at around 50. Now, if you look at the history, there are lots of corporate governance problem with this company. However, over last 1 year, the management has significantly changed for this company. Second, importantly, we are now seeing initial green shoots of a turnaround happening in. For this company. So for this company, yes, a risk as a company is much more higher. There is very little proof just based on the historical performance that one can take. So there is a little bit of kind of confidence that we have to take based on our understanding of what is the management's plan about going forward into the future, how they would be executing it, what is the quality of the management over there, if they have previous experience, what kind of experience that they have brought in that particular company and how it worked out. So we have analyzed it all on those lines to understand if we can see a much more sustainability over there. Unlike our large cap product, in the small cap product we have started one more thing. In the large cap product, our typical buy call used to be of the kind that you need to buy this company or buy up to say certain percentage of allocation of your portfolio. Meaning if you are trying to buy, put 1 lakh rupees into ITC, then it would suggest how much part of ITC we can do now so that we can do a sort of a dollar averaging over there. Now, in the small cap product, we clearly understand the risk in small cap tends to be much more higher than it is normally perceived by people in the bull run. So we want to not just restrict ourselves to just saying buy, we also want to start giving advice here as to what percentage of your portfolio should be this. So when we gave our call on OnMobile, we clearly understood that this was a very high risk strategy, so there was much more important need for mitigating the riskiness of investment in On Mobile by not exposing your portfolio to a very high percentage of investment. So we decided that for a small cap, it will not just be a case of giving a buy, but it will also be how much percentage of your portfolio would be buy. So we started that also with On Mobile. Now, typical small cap company that is much more recognized is, let's say, take the case of Pinnathi Organics. Now, this is a company that is a very niche producer, has been growing its both sales as well as earnings very significantly, has tended to maintain a strong margin, a very niche producer, small producer, but a very niche producer in certain specialty chemicals. In two of its chemicals, he has developed a certain kind of a monopolistic or oligopolistic kind of power because of this and market size. And as a result of which he can command a sort of a higher margin. The company that is also focused on cost optimization. Now, this is a typical kind of a small cap company that most of the people would like to have in his portfolio. Now, I do understand that when you look at just our in a dashboard, you would come across lots of companies where their prices may already be much more above their MRP. Now, key things to understand with a small cap company is that unlike in the large cap product, I am not definitely looking at giving you, say, 2 buy calls or 3 buy calls in a month. My focus is largely to give you, if I can be a bit extreme conservative, than to say give you just 2 to 3 buy calls, but they have to be excellent buy calls so that they make a huge impact on your portfolio going forward. The aim is to buy great companies or highly deep value companies, but at a reasonable price. We internally like to call it at GARP, that is growth at reasonable price. You need to buy growth, but the growth, we should not be paying too much of a premium for growth. Now, if you look at certain company like, let's say, in a Gujarat Pipavav, we just were having a discussion on Gujarat Pipavav with my analyst over here, and he told me that in a Gujarat Pipavav, as its current market price stands, is nearly factoring whatever the utilization growth that the company would get over the next 3 years, plus whatever the planned capacity is, and still the price of 200 PE is not justified as of now. He believes that on a most optimistic basis, a price of around 170 to 160 is what something can someone can easily give, even looking at the most optimistic scenario that is likely possible. If you see over here, even though the company going forward may do actually very well, the value may not be realized by the investor for at least next 4 or 5 years till the company becomes achieves a certain kind of size. And this may drastically dent your long-term returns that an investor can hope for. So companies like Gujarat Pipavav, even though they are highly overvalued, we are still kept because we believe that over the short term, especially in 2015, we expect a much more higher level of volatility in the market. And this, in those volatility, we believe that some of these companies can be at the discount price or great other great values. Now, the other part, or much more frequently asked question by most of my subscribers and registered users is this the final roster list of 25 companies on which we would be giving our valuation of present or enough calls? No, actually we track nearly another 35 to 40 companies that you do not see over here. We are looking at either some catalyst, we are either looking at some change that may happen over there, some other turnaround companies wherein we are looking at whether is it a right time. So take for example, we are actively looking at Suzlon, but is it a right time to think about Suzlon, or would we want some more changes to happen within Suzlon before and better price for us to start and considering Suzlon as a much more serious candidate. Now, friends, could you just help me know whether you can listen to my voice? Clearly, some people have given me okay, let me check if I can do something about the audio. Thanks Arvind, and thanks Taran for letting me know whether the audio is clear or not. So if you look at Suzlon, even Suzlon, if you all would have been following news, Suzlon just did a very big asset sale of another repo business renamed as Senvion for $1.16 billion, which we believe would help reduce its balance sheet stress, but still it is an asset sale, so the balance sheet size will also and a contract, its sales would contract and its profit should also contract. So we need to see furthermore whether they go ahead with a much more better optimized working capital or not, whether they can earn operating profit on their Suzlon part of the business or not going forward or not. So we are looking at multiple stages of for Suzlon or other turnaround companies. So these are some other 30-40 companies that we keep on looking. Now, why we are doing this? See, we understand that we have identified some 24-25 companies which we believe that if we can get at a decently good price, they may give very long-term good returns for our investors. But if in the eventuality that many of these companies do not come to our price, we would definitely be looking at updating this roster list. We will be removing those companies in which we believe the likelihood of having that is very low given the difference between the MRP as well as the current market price that the company may have at that time, or we believe that the story does not have that much value as we had initially thought, then we would be dropping out these companies and we would be moving, we would be adding some other companies. Now, unlike our other products, we understand the risk of the small cap is very high. So we have added another feature this for this particular product is any small cap company, if we give a buy call during the period in which we are part of the plan, even if in the later half, later years, if you are not part of MoneyWorks Home subscriber, whenever we are giving a sell call, that first sell call will be received by you. So if we give any buy call in 2015 and let's say if we give a buy call, we are given a buy call in 2014 for all mobile, let's say somewhere in 2017 or 2018, we give a sell call on it, even though in 2017 or 18 you are not my customer, you will receive that sell call. We understand that this is very, very important given the risky nature of the small cap companies. I think it is okay if it's a large cap company if we do not communicate it, because these are companies who have clearly established their economics and business models. So it's easy for an investor to get alternative opinion from, say, other service providers. We believe it is our fiduciary duty, especially in the small cap companies, to keep on and handholding to the customer till the last moment. Now, I hope I have helped you understand how we are looking at small cap. We are looking at high growth companies or companies available at deep discount, but we want them at either reasonable price and preferably at dirt cheap price. Now, over the last few weeks, we have also gone through a change in the way our website was designed. Few quick things that I would like you to look at is, and I would want you to start using it so that now you can get a much more better value out of the kind of website. So one is clearly, instead of kind of giving a very long prose about what the company does and what company is likely to do in its business, we have kind of divided that part, that is about what the company does, into something called a business model. Now the way that the business model ties arrange, they themselves kind of speak volumes about what we are trying to help you understand. At the center, we are definitely trying you to understand how does a company like Gujarat Pipavav create its value for its business, how does it intend to earn its cash. Now this value tile is rested on two clear things, that is cost structure of the company and the revenue streams of the company. Now we believe that the revenue stream of the company is driven by these three things, that is one is pricing power, second is key resources that the company has, and what are the key activities. So think of a pharma company. A key activity for a pharma company would typically be its R&D activity, sales and distribution activity. A key resources would clearly be how much strength of its R&D personnel are. Second, for a pharma company, does it have any clear cut partnership with say larger MNC companies which can help it in a distributed sell a generic and medicines and in the global market. On the other hand, let's say if you are looking at pricing power, companies with a very strong moat would typically tend to show whether they can pass on whatever the inflation pressure is they feed on their raw materials or their energy costs to their customers or not. On the other hand, we believe the cost structure depends upon what is the capital intensity of this business. Now, companies like refineries, companies like mining, they may tend to have very high capital intensity, meaning a company would have to keep on investing a large amount of money to enough support its sales growth. While on the other hand, FMCG kind of a companies, companies that are more consumer oriented, more service oriented, they would see much more lesser level of capital intensity. But key thing to understand is capital intensity over here is not just related with respect to say a capex, typically understood as a fixed capital investment. Now some companies like FMCG companies would also have to do huge amount of marketing and ad spends to keep their brand alive. So if you take an example of Zydus, it has to keep on expending a huge amount of capacity of marketing and advertisement revenue to get a sales growth. We have typically seen that whenever it has been conservative on its advertisement cost, it has resulted in either degrowth or very lackluster sales growth. So this also is seen as a kind of capital intensity by us in this kind of a scenario. On the other hand, working capital analysis, I think working capital analysis is a significant part given sometimes companies have a tendency, especially during the recessionary times, of dumping their goods onto their distributors and dealers or either not paying their vendors on time. So working capital analysis is the first thing that would flag off whether we can clearly identify a business model that is now becoming weak or not. And along that, with that is the balance sheet strength, which is clearly understood by us. If the company can support its growth based on the debt equity or the kind of capital structure that it is having, please understand, it's not necessary that just because a company has a very high debt, it will be very high risky. If a company is in a very highly regulated environment with very and a highly assured, say, revenue structure, with very highly assured cost structure, it may make sense to have a very high level of debt. A good example could be a hydropower company. While in the initial part, when it is just in the project execution stage, when it is building a hydropower company, it might not be a good way to have very high debt. But once the project is commissioned, when it is producing, it makes sense for a company to have very high debt so that it can increase its return on equity. And given the fact that the revenue as well as the cost is assured for the company, the balance sheet will be something that it can easily support based on its profit margins and earnings. Now, we hope you use this tool to understand what is the business model of the company. So if I take for an example, just let's say value creation for Gujarat Pipavav Power. So you can clearly see that the minus is flagging out few things like utilization of the port capacity, the fact that it is very close to JNPT port. Third, it's an association with its parent company, APM Terminals, which help it in a garner much more better client business in the shipping part. This being the key answer for its value creation part. On the revenue part, clearly, again, so there will be a story building up from a value creation to revenue to cost and then to revenue subparts. So while some of the points would get repeated, the aim is to help you understand how the cash is being generated. Now, if I take the valuation part, before introducing this segment of the tile, we were just focused more on giving the price calculator as a key tool without helping you understand how to bring about those variables that make part of the price calculator. Over the next few weeks, you would see few more features getting added over here. I will try and explain those features also over here so that you can make some sense out of it when it is introduced. Now, if you see, key variables that an investor would look at is what is his expected EPS growth rate or his expected book value growth rate if it is a bank or an NBFC kind of a company. What is the rate of return that he is expecting, that is the cost of equity, and what is the future PE is willing to give to the that company. Now, people tend to give a very high future PE looking at its current growth rate. One of the key things one needs to realize is that you ought to give a future PE that the company will command 5 years from now. So say if you are doing it for Jubilant FoodWorks. Now, it is easy to see that the Jubilant FoodWorks is a very high, growth company as of now. But the key thing to answer is, if sitting in 2015, can you foresee that post 2020 also it would tend to command a very high growth rate, or it would tend to be a very high return on capital business? If it is not going to be high growth rate or tend to be a very high return on capital oriented business in 2020, and it would have, let's say, return on capital will come down back to its and the cost of capital, then it would tend to enjoy just about an average and a PE, which for a company like that is based in India should not be more than 13.5 to 15. Now, in order to make an understanding of what kind of PE you should be giving, or what kind of EPS growth rate you should be giving, we wanted to help you understand how things should be going forward. So going forward, you will be seeing in this blank space that is there, you will be seeing valuation notes for each of the companies that would help you understand how the analysis coming or across this and understanding this kind of a company. Second, let me take a better company. Let me see. your writing. Just give me a second. And so if you look at, say, Infosys, now I was looking at this block. This will be there for each and every company for which there is a peer valuation that is available. Now, if you see at, say, it's something like an Atul, peers are not so easily available. So you're seeing a blank over there. And for Gujarat people, Adani Ports is not a very good comparison peer because of the size of operations are very different. But if you look at Infosys, we have given you what is how we look at our peer valuation. What is other competitors like TCS, Wipro, and HCLTech, and how does he stack up? Whether it is the margin of safety over here, the EPS growth rate over here, and rate of return. Plus, what we have also done is we have given you an industry's valuation of this. So, let's say there are companies that have, let's say, a margin of safety at 20. There are certain and other companies who have margin of safety of 70, even within the IT business, and an average that is coming for 37. So this will have some very small cap, mid cap kind of companies also who are having very high and a margin of safety. Same, we are also looking at what is the EPS growth. So I think 25 is clearly HCL Technologies for EPS growth. Most of the companies are somewhere close to 70. And the minimum growth rate that a peer is enjoying in the IT business is closer to 12. And what is the kind of rate of return that is there for this company? And what is the PE? I think 17 is probably RS software or something like that. And the kind of PE that has been given by the analyst. So these are the numbers that have been given by the analyst for the whole of the industry sector. You can use this panel to see how the valuations may change. So if I were to look at, say, how would Infosys do if, let's say, you were to do as well as, say, HCL Technologies, if he were to wrap up his growth clearly as high as what an HCL Technologies can do if, through his presence in infrastructure management business. Now, assuming he can do somewhere close to 25%, 3,200 would be what would be the fair value of Infosys, but you are clearly assuming that Infosys will grow at that phenomenal rate that we are expecting HCL will do, and only then that kind of evaluation can be commanded. Same way, if you want to see what kind of a PE that the company can enjoy, we are now giving you a PE graph. We would eventually take it to a 10-year kind of a PE graph, giving you how the PE of the company has been over the years. As of now, we have just dumped data up to the last 5 years. So you can clearly see that at least over the last 5 years, the PE has clearly moved from 31 at the high to close to just above below 14 at the lowest. So you can go back and check if how would the valuation get impacted if that kind of a thing were to play out. So say and a PE of closer to 30. Now, why are we trying to do this? One of the key reasons we realized why we want to do this is that in the bull run, people need to understand that when they are using a calculator, what is the current price also signifies. So let me take, for example, an example of Maruti to help you understand what I mean by this. If you see Maruti Suzuki's price is 3,600 as of now. So let's use our valuation calculator and see what kind of, let's say, growth that the company can get. So let's say you are clearly not happy with a very low PE of 17. You believe that a company like Maruti has some amount of moat, so, but it is still in the auto industry with a very high competition. You think that it can clearly enjoy a PE of, say, close to 22 or 23, let's say. And now you want to see what does 3,600 as a value means, what is the market factoring as a growth. So let's say 3,600 typically means that the market is clearly estimating somewhere close to 22%, 23% as to 22 to 23. If I look at 10 year X-ray, did Maruti ever achieve that? Now I am when one sees a 10 year X-ray of an Maruti, you see that while yes, it has done something of much more better than 23% over the short term, but this has come over in a much more in a very low lean period. And that too, it has sustained it for just 1 or 2 years only. It has not done so significantly over the over the consistent stretch of 5 years or so. So you can realize that even though if you do not agree with my valuation of 2009, but at the current price of 3,608, it's clearly a sell kind of a company or company that you definitely know you need to avoid to some extent or not. So unless the key thing to understand over here is that in order for you to make a significant profit at 3,600, the company's actual growth rate would need to be much more higher than 23. So if you estimate 23 and the actual company's earnings growth rate come down to as close to as 30, then you can expect, say, clearly enough about another 1200 bucks, so about 30% growth. But if the 30% kind of earning growth does not end up happening over the next 5 years on a compounded basis, then you are much more likely to make a very low level of returns or much more likely to make negative returns because the company may, growth may already have been factored in or it may be already overvalued as of now. So we wanted to help you use this so that you can also understand what is the market expectation as of now. If I were to use this to just look at what the BE of the Maruti Suzuki has been at least for the last 5 years, so you can see it has fluctuated somewhere in between 35 and it has all, that was in 2010, but largely it has stayed in between 21 and only in 2014 it has tended to go much more higher back to 35. If assuming this was a well long-term kind of a P profile, you, just a P itself can signal you that the market is pricing the most optimistic kind of scenario. It has already priced a very high level of growth. It is already by because of the high kind of P that it is looking at as of now. So this is how we would like you to look. The other features that I would like you to go through is one is same way for like price to equity, we have done a price to sales. Price to sales also is a good way to compare a company whether people are paying much more higher level of valuation to it than what it has historically enjoyed. You can see it by comparing it with sales numbers. Key thing to look over here is that implicit assumption is over here that the margins have been stable over here. Very good tool to use, especially for companies that are going through a huge amount of cycle because of the kind of operating leverage they have. Key thing to remember is they have operating leverage and not just a financial leverage, or that is one of the margins that were contracted because of debt. And same way for companies which have very high, capital structure, which have very high debt and equity, which need to use very high capital intensity to grow their business. We believe enterprise value to EBIT is a much more better way of understanding whether another company is overvalued or not. Now, in this whole tool, if you see, there is one new price to book value, same way, especially good for say a very high capital intensity business, both on the engineering side as well as banks and NBFCs. We are creating something called as bull and bear scenario. As of now, if you click, you kind of get to know as something as coming soon over here. What we are trying to create is we are going to help you know two scenarios, that is a bull scenario and a bear scenario. You can clearly understand what is my worst case scenario and what is my possible optimistic scenario in the bull side. What are the key assumptions I have made? And if you were to buy it at current price, what kind of return you can expect over the next 3 years on a fundamental basis? If you need this particular kind of return, let's say you want 18% return by buying into Kane India, what price should be bought at? How does your current purchase looks at if looked at over 3 years, 4 year perspective? Are you being too optimistic or too pessimistic? So it is supposed to answer that kind of a question. You will clearly understand that whether there is a huge downside for the if you invest in now. So for example, let say I clearly understand that one of the companies that we have sort of clearly bungled up is in Kane India, we did not anticipate a sudden sharp correction. Our whole hypothesis was that while there was a case for a lower crude price, we did not see crude price falling below 75 to 80 price range. Even though our current expectation of a crude price continues to stay at 75 to 80 rupees, sorry, $80 per barrel, we do not clearly anticipate that the correction on the downside can be so high, so fast and so low. But however, let's say if I would have had a beer tool over there, it would have clearly showed that there was a 30% or 40% chance for 80 kind of a price, and that would have given us this kind of value. So you would have helped, it would have helped you understand whether the downside is very high or not. Same way when it comes from the upside, if you are going to buy today probably at let's say 3600, that tool would also help you understand whether you are overpaying for the company, looking at the most optimistic scenario also. If you buy, say, HCL technology at current price, it will help you understand what is the blue sky scenario over there, what is the probability of that company over there. So if I take a company like, say, Jyoti, now you will see that the expected EPS growth rate itself is 25%. Now for this company, the base case itself is 25%. The bull case would be a much more blue sky scenario at a much more higher say EPS growth rate. And if let's say that the possibility of a bull case scenario is close to 30% with a 40% likelihood for a 25% growth rate, and say a bear case is about close to 20%, then it might probably make much more better sense even to buy it at current price, provided you understand the risk that in a downside, if actually 20% share tends to come in, then your downside is close to say I think should be close to 200. Yeah, so it should be close to 200. If you are okay with that kind of 20% kind of a risk, then you may actually think that it's something that you can afford, and you can for the small percentage of an ownership, that small percentage of portfolio that it may form part of your. So this is how we have designed a valuation tool. Now another key change that we are trying to make now is that if you look at the 10-year X-ray, till now it was largely a full table of some ratios over here, a probably good way of putting your assessment. We were putting in a management X-ray for in a small cap companies also over here now. We believe that key to understand of investment in any small cap is also to grade their management, because it is very critical in the small cap companies. And once this is done, and somewhere in between business models, there will be some 3 to 4 ratios that are typically not covered in our plain vanilla 10-year X-ray profile. It would help you understand what are the key ratios that the analyst himself is looking at while trying to understand whether the company is moving in the right direction or not. He'll give you what he's looking at, why is he looking at those ratios, and there will be those graphs that would get updated annually once annual reports are available, just as a part of 10-year X-ray. But this would vary, this would not be seen for each company. This would be different. So for Jyoti Laboratories, it could clearly be how much is doing on marketing spend. While for say company like Sun Pharma, it may be how much R&D spend he is doing. For a company like a Tata Sponge or let's say Tata Steel, it could be in how much capacity ramp up is happening or at what cost it is happening. So these kind of ratios would be what we are planning to do over the next month. So by end of February, this should be available for at least 50 companies and the small cap companies, and then we'll proceed to have it for whole range of 160 companies for now, and somewhere close to May, June, we will be targeting to have it for the whole of the 500 companies. With this, I think I have broadly covered how we have gone about designing our rising star and the major changes that we have made in the website. I will be taking some of the questions that you have given to us, and then if we have time, I will take whatever some of the questions that you have given to us right now. The first question is by Mr. Arun Jayapuria. His question is, your analysis is good, but you are very conservatively defining DPI and MRP, and that the reason we don't have much stock to buy in case my portfolio is totally dependent on your analysis. I think to some extent your analysis is correct. We tend to be extremely conservative. There is one thing that I've learned in my life is that I can never predict how the future is likely to go forward. There's huge amount of uncertainty how future is likely to play forward. I will give you an example from my own personal investment. I was one of the few people who had invested in Suzlon on the time of its IPO. Now, I clearly did not anticipate Suzlon going for a leverage buyout for Repower. I clearly did not anticipate product problems occurring in Suzlon. And this was some uncertainty that was not clearly factored. One can factor it in future and project it into future irrespective of how much amount of probability one can one tries and puts into it. But what I realized is that fortunately for me, at least I took a decision that because he had gone for a very kind of acquisition strategy that I clearly did not agree with because of the kind of price they had paid. Same was for Tata Steel as well as unfortunately for Tata Motors also for me that I kind of exited those companies. Now, because of this reason, we believe that being very conservative on how much premium one should give for the kind of growth that the companies can get is very crucial for an investor. I've generally seen that Indian investors tend to have very high fixation with growth without realizing whether the company that is growing is actually creating a value or not. So let me take a classic example that I used to probe it the company in each of my webinars. If you look at the kind of sales growth they have, that's phenomenal sales growth. It's gone from 15,000 crores to 85,000 crores. If one were to just look at even the profit numbers, it is a phenomenal number. From 800 odd crores to about 4,000 crores, so about nearly 5 times. But if one were to look at just its return on capital employed, that is how much capital he needs to employ to get that kind of growth, one sees that one may be better off putting his money in a fixed deposit rather than investing in a company like an L&T. If one were to look at even on the basis of say operating cash flows, one would see that except for 1 or 2 years, these operating cash flows have tended to be much more negative rather than earnings rather than positive, and that significantly impacts his return on capital over the long term because he needs to keep on borrowing more and more push up his to sustain his growth and sustain his operations. So this is we believe that too much fixation of growth and too much of premium to be paid on growth could be something that should be very, very, one needs to be extremely careful with. We have generally seen that buying great companies with good business models with high growth opportunities but not paying for that kind of a growth premium typically tends to work in our advantage. We have historically seen this happen when we have tended to buy ITC somewhere close to say 300 kind of a scenario or buy say Pidilite in 2013. We saw that kind of strategy makes much more sense over the longer term. I do believe that being a value investor in the period when the market is tending towards becoming a hyper-excited, bull run kind of a place, we might not do well, and I'm extremely comfortable with that kind of underperformance in that particular year. See, one of the key points that I always tend to make to my analyst over here is that if you were a value investor and you were sitting in 2007, you should have been out of the market in spite of the fact that 2007 was one of the most phenomenal markets. If your average return was 57%, and the average behavior of an investor was that he puts his money in any company and it was likely to double in that particular year. It is very, very tough to stay away from the market in that kind of a scenario because each and every of your competitors, whether he's other retail investor, friends of yours, or other analysts, everyone is simply going to ask you to buy. I believe that in that particular year, I don't mind sitting in cash. I don't mind my investors not investing. I would rather have them start selling. And so I think 2015, with the kind of valuations I'm seeing, I do not see that we have reached a place of a highly overexcited kind of stage wherein we are paying crazy valuations But we are reaching that, we are definitely reaching the stage that many of the good companies and great companies, they are now valued at their max. Meaning, there is a no loss valuation now. You cannot have any errors either by Modi, either by management, either by even an engineer in those companies to have to justify that kind of valuation. So for example, for Maruti, a single quarter in which there is a delay in the earnings to pan out can suddenly have impact on how Maruti's valuation would be or how much it can be good. And like, we tend to like to stay away from that kind of investment thesis. I would rather be conservative rather than be quite over optimistic. I think both 2013 and 2014, there's a number of calls that we gave should be a very clear indicator. 2013 calls on top 150 kind of product rate goes to 35-36. 2013 was a phenomenal year, not because of the last second half, but because of the August, July to August, when market was panicking. 2014, while a phenomenal year on the share price growth side, we were not finding that much value. So our number of calls came down clearly to just 12 to 15 number of calls. It clearly hurt. I would not be surprised that in 2015 it comes back to half again. So I would lucky if I can give just 8 to 10 calls, but that do well over the long term. The next question is by Mr. Arvind K. His question is your view on buying companies at PE of 70 to 100 if there is a good expectation of growth even then. Can one make many there also? A PE of 70 to 100 need not necessarily be a very large PE. The key thing to understand is why is market pricing it at PE of 70 to 100? It need not be a very high PE in the sense of the fact that sometimes it may have happened because either the margins have come down and the company itself is cyclical, so market is pricing it because of its asset rather than the earning power of the company. So it's giving it a high PE. In this kind of company, it must still make sense. Then there are growth kind of companies, companies like say Jubilant Foodworks or companies like Page Industries, who are growing at a phenomenal rate. They may be extremely good companies run by extremely great management. The key thing over here is that it is already trading at a PE of 70 to 100, and it already has then whatever the future growth that is likely to occur, it is clearly priced in now. So I will take a case of Jubilant Foodworks itself. So in I think if I'm not wrong, say somewhere in January 2013, Jubilant Foodworks came with its earning report, and in that earning report, they reported that their earnings had grown, but they had grown by 30%. Market at that time was factoring close to 50% kind of an earning growth rate, and that was the reason why it had given a very high PE to the company. If you look at on a standard basis without understanding expectations of the market, earning growth of 30% is actually a very good rate. But because market was already factoring a much more higher number, the company corrected about 8 to 10% in that particular day. Now, that is the kind of risk that you have with 72, when you pay a company that has a 7200 kind of a PE. Now, PE is a very blunt kind of a instrument also. That's why you have to see it on multiple ratios also. So sometimes a company may have very high PE. It may be because, not because of its earning, but because of the kind of phenomenal cash flow it may be throwing out. And in those cases, PE of 70 to 100 did not be very high PE. I hope that helps you understand what are the risks when you're buying a PE of 72, 100 kind of a company. The next question is by Arun Jaipuri. His question is, we expect buy call at least 1 to 2 in small cap, mid cap, and 1 to 2 in large cap. I also expect that I could give that kind of buy calls every month, but markets unfortunately are not in my hand. So I tend to be very risk averse when the market tends to be extremely over-optimistic on how future is likely to pan out. I would rather have extremely high buy calls when the market is panicking, so I can have my own select picks of what kind of meat I would like to have on my plate, rather than having a huge number of companies each and every month. My aim is to generate a sustainable return that is much more consistent over a much more longer term ILPT in terms of a decade rather than just 1 year or 1 odd year. I think I would not do well in some extreme kind of scenarios like when markets are going by 50-60% every year, or when things are in those kind of place. I'm actually very comfortable just being an average performer over there. I think believe that our core competency lies in helping you guys identify companies that can be part of your portfolio over longer term, and or even if they are for short term, they are there because clearly the risk reward scenario is extremely good in those companies. The next question is by Mr. Arvind K. His question is, in a market all-time highs, do we need to buy small caps with good prospect or blue chip for greater percentage of growth year-on-year basis? Arvind, I think as of now, if I were to go on the basis of how the kind of valuations we are seeing, I would actually stay away from blue chips as well as small caps unless until I get a very strong valuation sense. So I look at a high volatility because of likely, say, economic risks that are there in the global markets to buy into any company. My point being, while with blue chips, I would be much more comfortable buying a large portion of my portfolio, and with a small cap, a smaller portion of my portfolio. The key thing that I would like to see is that there is a risk-reward scenario that is very, very positive to me. Just because prices are increasing, it should not force your hand to start making an investment. One of the great videos that I would suggest you all guys, all of my clients and my subscribers and registered users to see is, curiously, it was released by Disney in 1934, just after the crash. Okay. I use this video to see whenever I think that I am extremely optimistic and I should be buying a company at strong P's because the market is doing extremely well. So this is Walt Disney Silly Symphony, The Grasshopper and the Ants. To make the story short, it's an old story we all know, but I think we need to see it every time when we become extremely bullish. It talks about a grasshopper who then he enjoys his life and things are going extremely well in the season. It's a summer season. And it does not want to work. And ants who are very hardworking and they are trying to save in the summer season so that they can enjoy during the winter. And when the winter comes in, the grasshopper has to be helped out by ant as per as the Disney story goes. And ants have a very if it would not have been ants, then grasshopper would have not had enough, would not have survived that cold winter. I think one should see that story, but keep that investment in perspective. Keep a bull run when they speak about summer. Keep a bear run when they speak about winter. Keep about and think about value investors when you see ants, and think about momentum investors and a typical retail investor who just wakes up and things are going extremely good for the markets during the summertime. So I think keep that in mind and have a look. It's a good video and will help you understand how to go about designing your own investment thesis for yourself. Next question is by Mr. M.S. Ram Gopal. This question is, what part of portfolio should be invested on any one stock in mid-cap? I would suggest typically a rule of thumb of 10%, not more than 10% in the large cap, somewhere close to 5% to 3% for small cap, and a mid cap in between 7.5% to 9%, 8%, 9%, depending on how what is the quality of the mid cap is. But it's a rule of thumb. You can have a play around it. The key thing is that going overboard, even in the large cap, can be extremely risky for you. However, as I stated, especially for the rising star companies, we would be giving out how much percentage of your portfolio this company should be. And if, let's say, if it's case of Automobile, if the things are going bad, we will ask you to keep reduce your or get out of it. Or if the things are going better on our turnaround basis, that would help you start increasing your purchase of that particular company. The next question is by Mr. Karthikeyan. His question is, I am afraid to invest in mid caps. I have lost a lot of money by investing in mid caps in the past. How can I do it confidently? The key, Karthikeyan, I believe that most of people end up losing a huge amount of money is when they invest in small cap and mid cap. There are few things that a person needs to know when he starts investing in mid cap and small cap. In a mid cap and small cap investment, you need to be very conscious about the kind of the company you are buying. Second, you need to understand that a company can always lose out its business model. So lots of companies over the last 7-8 years have come in the education business, but if you see clearly, very few have them actually created any kind of sustainable business model for themselves. Even without thinking that there is a bad corporate governance involved over there, I would rather say that there is more likelihood of a company scaling, because education actually is a very, very hard business when you think on it from a business perspective, because there are so many vested interests, there are so many players involved, barriers to entry actually is very low. Any professor with a reasonably strong command on a certain subject can easily start off his own class. So the barriers to entry is very small. Creating your own competitive advantage is very hard. Bringing in scalability is extremely hard. So my point is, mid caps especially and small caps equally would tend to sometimes lose out their way. So you need to be careful about that, in the sense that you need to keep on periodically checking out whether they are moving as per your expectations or not. The third point is, please never pay extremely high value for growth. Now, as the bull run is going to mature now, you see that I believe second half of 2015 would be a period when the volatility does not increase, and second half of 2015 will be a period when you will see a phenomenal increase in the number of IPOs that would come in. And most of the time, understand that promoter is selling his stake. He will sell his stake at the highest possible price that he can get, meaning that buying a small cap, mid cap, or even a large cap company during IPO did not necessarily be a very, very attractive strategy. You may get listing gains, but this is a short-term affirmal plus, and you tend to attract a short-term capital gain tax also. But it becomes more like a trading rather than just an investing. Well, there is a paradox. If the offer is very good, you would see a huge participation, you get peanuts number of shares. If the offer is very bad, you get large number of shares, but they are likely to not perform. So I tend to not so much invest into IPOs. I tend to invest into these companies if I find them attractive 2 or 3 years down the line, when most of the people are forgotten about it. So key thing is, again, don't overpay for the for the company's growth level, or especially the growth that the companies have had over the last 2 to 3 years. And the last part is, see to it that the mid-cap company or small-cap company is not a very large percentage of your portfolio. Let's say you buy into a mid-cap company, it's nearly 5% of your portfolio. You made a wrong decision, it nearly went bankrupt. How much is the loss that it would generate? Your loss on the stock may be about 80% or 90%, but your loss on the portfolio level is just is always going to be less than 5%, because your capital invested is very less into mid-cap and small-cap company. So that is another risk management strategy that you need to use. Buy great companies, don't overpay for growth, tend to be extremely conservative, and last, and I don't see to it that it's not very your portfolio is not highly focused into these particular stocks. Because if things go bad, then your portfolio can your portfolio value can deteriorate at a much more faster rate. Next question is by Mr. Krishna Alam. His question is, are you going to add new stocks to your list in coming days, or are you keeping these stocks, 24 stocks, only for entire year? I believe we are going to add this 24, we are going to add more stocks to this list. Though we tend to maintain our list closer to even 25 to 30 range, so that in the number of stocks, though it's not a kind of a rule, but we are trying to use that as a way to keep it much more manageable for our investors also. But the metric that we are going to see is if there is a low likelihood of seeing these, say, 25 companies being had for investment, or we see that these companies deteriorating, then it makes more sense for us to have a new roster or keep on adding new companies, so that then we do not lose out on some great story that is playing out and we are not visible of it. We are not seeing it. The next question is by Mr. Pulak Mishra. His question is, what methodology do you use for valuation for mid and small cap, especially if the financials have been inconsistent? In the case of companies where the financials have been inconsistent, We use multiple methodologies. One of the methodologies that we tend to look at is what is the asset value of the, or reproduction value of the asset of that particular company. We believe that is a much more better way of looking at the company than just looking at, you know, what is its earnings or normalizing its earnings or taking its last year's earnings and projecting it forward. Second, especially in a company where the income, there has been lots of instances, we like to understand why these inconsistencies are coming. So that quality check is much more important before we even select that stock. What we want to understand is that, is it because it was out of the control of the management, or is it because the management moved? If it was out of the control of the management, we still would like to look into that stock deeper. But if it is because, say, the management goofed up, we do not want to have it, that company itself, because, you know, there is a question mark on the management being the good stewards of investors' money as itself. But in the case where the company was itself in a very difficult scenario, what we would like to understand is how the company's management has been responding to that kind of risk. Has it been trying to de-risk it? Has it been clearly open to understanding that this is a significant a problem in its business model, and how is it trying to address it? Only in cases where we see that the solution that they are giving has more probability of success, we tend to take that company, and even within that we use a probability-based scenario, a decision tree kind of case, wherein we like to see it on a positive spin of a scenario with lots of things going in its favor, and also look at what if things go is when many things do not fall in place, and how does it value still stands, and one or two scenarios in between, so that we tend to understand whether the price at which we can recommend this stock, what is the kind of future that the company would have given the risk that we see, the likelihood of the negative scenario and the likelihood of the positive scenario. I believe understanding these probabilities is very, very key to making a decision, especially in companies which may have had historically inconsistent performance. The next question is by Mr. George Samuel. A good question. His question is, in 2015, what are the triggers we would watch for market to go or crash, and the levels it can reach either direction? Why it would be hard for me to comment on the levels it can reach, because it would be subject to how much benefits, how much economic value is created in the economy, how much value is created by the companies, how much earning growth the companies can see. And on the downside, it clearly depends upon how high it has gone to and understand how low it can go. But what factors you need to see, I think there I can really help you out. I think three things, at least on basis of what kind of data would be clearly available to you. Any concentrated action by central banks in reducing interest rate need not actually be a very positive thing. You need to understand that that may actually signal a kind of a very weak global scenario, if not at least in India. Second, any failure by the government of India in launching the second generation reforms over the next 6-7 months would be clearly seen as a negative by the international investors. Even if the government ends up doing that, let's say post 2016, when most of the Indian investors expect the current government to have sort of majority in the Rajya Sabha and bulldoze through lots of reforms that have been stuck for over more than a decade now. I believe that the key thing is the budget that we are likely to see on 28th of Feb, whether it has enough streaks of reform in it, whether the finance minister at least gives us a hint of what kind of policy direction the government is likely to take for the next 1 year. On the negative side, I would like to see how the growth pans out for China, how the growth pans out for Europe. I'm extremely worried for both of them, China as well as Europe. I believe that the kind of numbers that we are creating, 7.5% kind of number, may actually be misleading numbers. The actual growth may be much more lower. I based my understanding of this based on two or three other metrics that I tend to look at. One is how much growth has been there for, say, electricity consumption in China. Second, how much percentage growth has been of the racks, that is the railway racks. That tells me how much trade is actually happening in China. These are much better metrics for me to understand China. Third, I also look at what kind of investment scenario is in China, especially in the real estate market. Real estate market, I think, is going doing very badly. I don't expect a crash in the real estate market in China, but I do expect a sort of a correction in the real estate market. And that may be a bit of a decrease in the size of investment, and that typically happens in the gross fixed capital of China, and that may hurt commodity kind of companies, especially say iron ore, zinc, copper kind of companies. On the other hand, if crude does fall down to 27, I would not take it as a positive. I would actually take it as a negative, because 27-30, these kind of ranges would actually signify a kind of a demand destruction that is happening in the global economy. It would especially make in India kind of a campaign very, very tough for the government of India to execute. On the positive side, reform process, much more stronger growth in US, a bit of an inflation in Europe. I would be happy if the inflation can at least edge towards 1%. Slowing growth, but growth trend is just stabilizing around in between 5.5 to 6% for China would be especially helpful. But I would not be surprised if the slowing down of a growth continues to remain a challenge for China over the next 5 to 6 years. I believe that China is now a very matured economy. So unless and until it can focus more on innovation and developing brands by its industries, it would be harder for it to get the kind of growth rate that it had got pre-2007. I believe one should look out for expecting that by the end of this decade, somewhere, but much more closer to 2025, or we should not be surprised if China actually grows not more than 2.5 to 3%. So I believe that at that rate, the size of economy, 2.5 to 3% itself would be a phenomenal growth and much more sustainable growth. China then can actually be a much can emerge as the second and a growth engine for the global economy. And actually, this would be much more beneficiary for the global economy as a whole, and in balancing out the trade imbalances that has happened because of China's pursuit of export-oriented strategy. So this is the key focus I would look out. On the macro side, highly expensive IPOs could be clear signal of a bull run. You should start cutting down your investment or your exposure to equity, start sitting on cash. You might at the max lose out 7 to 8 months of a phenomenal equity bull run, but understand that post crash, you will find lots of these companies that your friends are investing as of now at phenomenally dirt cheap prices. So look out for that as a marker at least. If you see companies, small cap, mid cap companies who come out with IPOs that are 35, 40 kind of fees, it's a clear indicator that you need to start in the cutting down your exposure to equity markets, especially if these kind of companies are coming out at a faster rate on the IPO side. The next question is by Arvind K. His question is asset valuation by brick and mortar method correct for a company which has been wound up by like HFD? It could be correct way, but the key thing that you need to understand over there is that you have to have the clear-cut ability to understand the value of the asset. So if you think of, let's say, the HMT is sitting on a huge amount of tract of lands, and if that land is on its book, maybe it is, say, valued at the price of 1 rupee or 2 rupee, as is the case with, say, Air India or LIC, LIC's headquarters, and that land is in, say, on around Marine Drive, then the value of the land is not there on the book itself. But on the other hand, let's say HMT is sitting on a land somewhere in outskirt of Nasik. It has clearly built up in a huge structures over there, and it has clear. It is not possible for anybody other than a machine tool person to actually use that asset. That value of the land would not be realized. Then the value of the asset would be someone who can come in and turn around that kind of asset, or can strip that asset, and you will get only that kind of asset level valuation only. So you can look at asset valuation, but you also have to look at what kind of liabilities it also has against it. So if, let's say, HMT's asset valuation comes down to 1,000 crores, I have not seen HMT, but let's say this is a hypothetical number we can get after looking at its current asset as well as its gross fixed asset. But it would have certain liabilities. Tax liabilities are frequently something that is missed out by asset values, by investors who do asset valuation. Second, employee salaries that is unpaid. It is not just a contingent liability or that may be under dispute. It is something that has to be understood, and they would have the first right even over other lenders and vendors. Third tier is money outstanding of vendors, and then lastly the money outstanding to banks. So only on the net asset basis, if it makes sense, you can look at. But the clear thing is the liquidation has to be possible. It has to be happening. Otherwise, you problem could be even though the value may be realized, it can maybe and it may end up getting realized over much more longer term. It will end up get so you may have bought it at 100 bucks. Its asset value may be 200 rupees per share. But if it get realized over a period of 10 years, your actual returns may be much more closer to say 6% or odd. 6 to 7% odd. Now, on the other hand, if you that is the reason we do not like asset-based valuation in certain companies like say HPCL or BPCL. See, HPCL in asset valuation, one of the key assumptions that you make is that the investor who is buying, he is either seeing or he has the ability to make changes in management. He can clearly throw on the current management for bringing a new, better management. Or he can strip the company of its asset, liquidate it, so that he can at least realize its asset value. Or at the worst, he has the ability to institute in a certain changes. So typically, if you look at Carl Icahn, he would typically, when he enters into some company in US, he would be very public about the kind of changes that he wants it within a company. He would keep on arguing with the management. He will keep on forcing management to think along his lines and force them to change their management policy also. So a great case with Apple, he was one of the few people along with David Einhorn who were instrumental in forcing Apple to kickstart their dividend policy also of giving I think about $10 billion as a dividend each year. With this, I would like to bring the current the webinar to an end. I understand some of you had questions related to top 150. Within the next 2 weeks, we will be conducting a seminar and webinar on top on all the companies. So at that time, we'll take all the suggestions that you have with respect to companies, any other company that you have. I hope this will help you understand our product of Rising Star better. And if you have any other advice to us, do give us those advice. We would like to make this product much more better and helpful for you. With this, I would like to bring the webinar to a close.